यस
स्टार्टेड रिकॉर्डिंग। So now you are able to see the whiteboard, right? Everything is fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we'll start our discussion. So last class, we have started our arches, okay? So that is, buckling of these arches we have seen. So generally, this buckling of arches, it is very difficult, okay, to get analytical, the solutions. So analytical closed form solutions, it becomes very complex, and maybe only for some special cases only, we can derive. So if it is a complicated case, like a concentrated load, and suppose if you are having an arch like this, say, okay, so it is a simply supported arch. Let us say you have a concentrated load, and then if you want to try to solve these type of problems, closed form solutions are, little complex. It's very difficult actually, okay, to arrive at the solution. So by some approximation this way or that way, one can find out the solutions here. Or maybe you can use numerical techniques like, finite difference we discussed in it long back, or FEM, say. So they are much more better than, easy to solve these type of equations. But if there is some special cases, say, so like for example radial load, so these type of problems, maybe yes, you can get a closed form equation itself. So this just remember. And then we have said that there are two things which are widely used in arches. One is Bosnick's equation. So this is based on just your Euler-Bernoulli, the beam theory, so this theory itself. And then the other one is, the Lamb's equation, which is also same as Euler-Bernoulli itself, but some small, the modifications you can make. Like for example, an Euler-Bernoulli beam theory, say, we assume that, the axial strain, okay, at the, your centroid, okay. So this, there is nothing, it is inextensible like that we assume. And then plane sections, they remain perpendicular to the cross section before bending and after bending also, okay. So in Lamb's equation, some of these things are relaxed, okay. So now you can incorporate, like for example, you see plane sections remain plane, say, they may not remain perpendicular, okay. So still they may be like this. You can bring out, some of these complications, that is effect of shear, the Timoshenko beam theory, whatever we have. So those things can be incorporated in our Lamb's equation. So you can say that Lamb's equation is something, much more general. It is like, Timoshenko beam theory also can, you can incorporate shear strain, and you can do all these things itself. So last class we have derived this Lamb equation. I have sent you the textbook, okay. So now when it comes to the arches, we don't have even the proper textbooks are not there, okay, even in the literature. So beams and classical things, you have a lot of textbooks are there, but when it comes to buckling and analysis of arches, this is the only book which we have found out, this Russian book actually, okay. So I hope all of you have got this textbook. I think in WhatsApp, we have shared this book itself, okay. Now, as far as this course is concerned, say, if you are interested, you can study the full book. As far as the course is concerned, you can just identify those sections itself, okay, where the Lamb's equation has been derived. And then you can directly go to this part 2, where it is a stability analysis has been mentioned. So these two are sufficient as far as this course is concerned. No need to study that vibration analysis, strength analysis, we are not going into details, okay. So last class we already derived for the Lamb's equation, so you have taken a general curvilinear element, okay. So last class we already derived. I'm just so it is for a generalized case. It is subjected to this radial load, then you have this tangential load, so this type of, this is Q and this is P, and then you have even the movement load also, okay. Just it's an approximation kind of a thing. So you have everything, okay. So now so you draw a tangent here, so you draw a tangent here, say, okay, to this curvilinear element. So this is our element, okay. So this angle, you know, we denote as some d phi, okay. So this is what we have denoted. And you know, you can so this coordinate system, so we have taken this as x coordinate, and this is you know, the y at the one point of this curvilinear element. So this was our shear force, and then you know, you have a bending moment here, and you have even the axial force also, okay. So at this place you know, so your n plus dm, so this is you know, m plus dm, and then you have this you know, the shear term also, which is q plus dq, okay. So this is our element. So this is a curvilinear rod, okay. So this is a curved like this. So now we are trying to derive our equations of equilibrium, and it is subjected to all kinds of loads, okay. So q is the radial load, we already wrote in the last class. So I'm just you know, the radial load here, and p is a tangential load or longitudinal, you know, you can say also, okay. And m is your some movement intensity. Generally this will be zero only, but just generalized, okay. So movement loads, and they are all defined per unit length, okay. So last class we already derived, like sigma x is equal to zero, then sigma y is equal to zero, that is fx forces in x direction, y direction, and then movement equilibrium also. I think we took the moments about this point, that is this O, okay. So you know, it is a straightforward, it is available in the book also. So we have got our equations as, you know, so dn by ds minus q by s plus p, sorry, this is not, this is, if I denote this as rho, okay. So where rho is our radius of curvature, let me write that also, okay, of our curvilinear element, okay. So rho is our radius itself. So the first equation we have got like this, and then assuming, so these equations we are assuming that, you know, d phi, this it is you know, a small, the angle, okay. So it is very small, so cos theta can be, you know, equated to 1, then sin theta can be taken as theta itself. And then the second equation, say we have got as you know, so for assuming small and other things, so dq by, you know, ds plus n by rho plus q is equal to 0. And the last equation, so that is our moment equilibrium, okay. So dm by, you know, ds minus q plus m is equal to 0. Now s is nothing but our arc length, okay. So this also you followed, right? So s is our arc length, so that is, you know, this entire arc, say, okay. So this is you know, our s, that is arc length, okay, of this curvilinear rod. So now these are the basically, you know, three equations of you see, the equilibrium, okay, for any curvilinear element. So it may be circular or it may not be, you know, non-circular. It is generally valid, okay. So because our radius of curvature, you know, we have assumed it can vary also. So these are the general, you know, the equations itself. So now if you assume that you know, if it is only circular, say, okay. So if assume that if it is only a circular arch, you know. So if it is only circular arch and only radial load only is there, okay. So there is no P is zero, then M is also zero. No tangential load, no, you know, these type of loads, say. So then, you know, we can even, you see, write, and then we can use, because of curvature, say, rho, ds, they are, all of them are linked. So we can write directly in terms of, you know, so dn by, you see, d phi, the angle itself we can do, that is a q. Then the second equation says, so dq by d phi, so this becomes, you know, minus n minus q times r, this is our radial load, okay. And dm by, you know, so d phi, say, is equal to q times, you know, r. So we can also you know, write like this, so which you can, you have used, so ds anyway is equal to r into d phi. So use this equation. So when there is a circular arch and you are having only radial load, okay, there is no other loads are there, so you can simplify these equations also. So these are the equations for a circular arch with a circular rod element, okay, with you know, the radial load. So these equations, you know, they are more slightly, you see, simple kind of a thing. In reality, you know, if it is a curvilinear, say, so these equations are complex. Now here also, and these equations you followed, right, I told you last class, generally, you know, Kirchhoff's equations, they say, okay. So these equations, you know, has been derived by this Kirchhoff. So this is how, you know, we write our equations also. Okay. So now if you are having any circular arches, say like for example, it is not important for us, but if you want to solve the same, say like for example, you know, if you have an arch like this. Okay. So one end is fixed, something like this. Okay. So and it is subjected to, you know, all these, you follow. The radial load, so that is some Q naught here, and one end is fixed. Okay, so you can take, this is our arch somewhere like this. Okay, so this is a crown. So if you take this as if you take any section, say okay, so phi is angle is measured from here, so you have any central angle. So now generally, you know, if you want to solve for you know, the bending moment, the internal forces essentially. So if you are having these internal forces, say, you can even club these two equations also. See, like for example, this equation, say, so Q you can club or you followed it, or you can differentiate this equation two times. So d square Q by d phi square will come. So n by, you know, d phi will come, and these terms comes into picture. So you can even write this expression, you know, so this equation, say, so differentiate. Okay. So d cube by this, you know, this equation on both the sides by, you know, some phi. So then, you know, you can slightly, you followed it. So this equation becomes, you say, d square q by d phi square plus q is equal to 0. So these two equations we have combined. So when you differentiate this twice, say, so dn by d phi comes, but anyway, dn by d phi is anyway your q itself, and then this becomes, you know, 0 itself. So you have a nice equation for a shear force, and you know this equation solution is, you can write as a sine phi, you know, plus b cos phi itself, and you can, you know, so now to find out this, and let us say at this end also, okay. So if we, to calculate internal force, let us say at this end we have some, you know, we have a section kind of a thing. So you have Q naught shear force approximately here. Then you have a bending moment at the free end. Okay, so if the arch is subjected to, you know, some kind of a shear, some kind of movement, and this one also, so you can use these equations to find out internal forces. So you can say that when phi is zero, say, okay, so phi, you can see it is measured from the free end. Okay, so phi is from the free end. So you can use some boundary conditions, you know, so q is equal to q naught, and at phi is equal to 0, say n is equal to, you know, dq by d phi. Okay, so that is minus n naught minus, you know, q naught into r actually. So that is from this equation. Okay, so dq by d phi, you know, so you can define, and you can write for the internal forces also. So so the shear forces, say, in the arch. Okay, so the shear force diagrams or something, if you want to calculate, so you can write this as q naught into, you know, cos phi minus, you know, n naught plus, say, q naught into r into sine phi. Okay, and similarly, you know, you can get this n also. So this is n naught cos phi, you can substitute in the previous equation, plus q naught you know, sine phi minus q naught r into 1 minus cos phi. Okay, so something like that. So this fashion, you know, you can use like this to find out internal forces. See, like for example, if you want to draw the bending moment diagram, the shear force, you know, in the arch, say, you can do like this, and you can use these type of equations, say, to find out these quantities. It is, anyway, for buckling, you know, this is not so important, but to find, draw the movement diagrams and others, you know, so this may help you. Okay, so now, you know, so to derive, so now instead of solving three equations, okay, all of them are interlinked. See, the first equation relates to n and q, then q and n, then m, q. So you can combine all these things in one go itself. Okay, that is how we write it in our you know, Euler-Bernoulli beam theory itself. So you can do, you can substitute n, q and all other things, so you will get one equation. Okay, so you can eliminate so d by ds. So for curvilinear elements, we can write this expression as, so 1 by rho, so dm by ds. So you can club all of them into one go. So minus p, this is our tangential load. So d of rho into q by, you say, ds plus, you know, so d by ds. So rho into d small m by ds. Okay. So minus m by rho is equal to 0. So this is one general, the equation itself. So you can club all the three for curvilinear rod, say. So this is a fundamental equation, you can say. Everything is written in terms of, the bending moment. Okay, so this is a general equation. Okay, so you club all the three in one go. So all these three equations, say, you substitute, Q, N, and eliminate the N and Q from these equations. So this is a general equation, you say, written in terms of movement for this curvilinear rod itself. So I think I should be careful. This is bending moment, and only thing. So this is only your load, small m. Okay, so here only the load comes. So now, as already I told, so now suppose if it is the circular rod, say, okay. So if it is circular rod, then, so rho r, this becomes constant, okay. So curvature is becoming constant, okay. Circular rod kind of thing. So now this becomes constant. So you can substitute ds is equal to r into d phi, and you can do all those things, okay. R into d phi, and you can simplify the above equation, say. So you can write this equation as d cube capital M by d phi cube plus dm by d phi. So this is the bending moment here. So on your right hand side, say r square. So you have p minus d cube by d phi plus capital R into small m, which is nothing but the movement load. Okay, minus d square m by d phi square. So this is the loads. So right hand side you are having the loads, tangential, longitudinal, then the movement load. So this is our basic, the equation of equilibrium for a circular rod. Okay, so this is our fundamental equation, you see. So if you want to solve, say, so you can solve this expression itself. Okay, so now this is so these equations are in terms of the internal forces like bending moment, shear force, and the axial force. Okay, now if I want to bring this strain displacement relations, say, okay, the relationship between strains and displacements. Okay, so this is slightly, followed, right? We will not go into the details. I will just write, the expressions itself. Okay, so it is more. So now let us say we have u is, a tangential displacement. Okay, so if u is our tangential displacement, okay, and it corresponds to longitudinal force, a normal displacement. So v. So this is our radial displacement or normal displacement. Okay, or radial displacement we can say. Okay, and the angle of rotation, say. Okay, so this is also we treat as one unknown. So which corresponds to the movement load. So this corresponds to small movement, and this corresponds to the longitudinal force, that is p, and this corresponds to q itself. Okay, so now if you see that of course one can derive also by taking this deformation, you can take equilibrium and you can do also. So in the book, say, so he has given a nice fashion. If you see the textbook, he has given a nice way to remember this expressions itself. Okay, so one can write the strains actually is so du by axial strain minus v by rho. So this for the axial strain. Okay, then so this is our shear strain. Okay, so the expression is so u by rho plus so dv by ds plus we have this psi, and then this this quantity is so d psi by ds. Okay, so these terms are defined like this. Okay, so this is our axial strain, so this is our shear strain, and this the additional is in the warping. Okay, so we can derive also, but we will not go into the the complicated followed, right? Otherwise we will deviate from our original the problem itself. See, now physical you can see a physical meaning also. See, like for example, the axial strain, if you see, say, so what does it tells you, the axial strain here? So if you see this axial strain, this portion, okay, so what is happening, there are two components are there. One is coming from the tangential displacement. Okay, so strain is nothing but you see a derivative here. So the tangential displacement says, so if you have any circular kind of a thing, so now the tangential displacement is u, and then you know your radial displacement say is you see the v. Okay, at any point. So now what it says is, you know, if there is an arc, is with the arch, or if your circular things, if it is subjected to, you know, some type of a radial load or whatever, so what happens is, you know, so you will, it will slightly, you know, let us say it is subjected to internal pressure, say, okay, so it will expand. Okay, so now if we want to try to find out the axial strain, how much, you know, things are there, so now what we are saying is it has a component from the tangential, this one, and it also will have a component from the radial also. Okay, that is V by rho itself. So this comes from the radial portion. So radially, how much, you know, the radius has increased, say. So that also will give you, you know, one extra, the axial strain component. And this comes from, you see, the tangential, you know, the displacement. How much, you know, your tangent displacement has increased. So that is du by ds. And this is a radial displacement. So all of you know, right? So previously also we have written, so ds is equal to, you know, r d phi we used to write. And then, you know, so if it is a displacement is v, say. So you can write the new distance as, you know, some r minus v into, you see, a d phi kind of a thing. And then when you try to compute the axial strain, say, that is a ds dash minus ds, okay, so that automatically it turns out to be, you know, this v by rho itself. Okay, so these are the equation. That is how physically I am just giving you, you know, the interpretation. So now in a similar fashion, you can give interpretation for shear strain. You can also interpretation for this additional warping. Of course, this is not important for us, but for completeness, for curvilinear rod, so you can include, you know, all these terms itself. So now, anyway, you see, we are not interested in the thing. So now let us see some special, you know, the cases. So these equations are valid for a general curvilinear rod, okay? So it has a shear also, it has even, you know, the warping itself, it has even, you know, the axial strain itself, so that rod. So these are generalized, you know, the equations. So now coming to our special cases, say. See, sometimes what we do in many cases, shear strain is, you know, the neglected, okay? See, like your Euler-Bernoulli beam theory, say, what do you do? What is the shear strain in Euler-Bernoulli beam theory? No. You remember, you know, in Euler-Bernoulli beam theory, what type of strains are there? No. See, in the beam theory, say, you remember, no. What is the assumptions you do? No. In Euler-Bernoulli beam theory, what do? If you take any plane cross section, say, okay? So plane cross sections, if you say that they remain perpendicular to axis, even this also, say, okay? So now they are perpendicular to your, you know, this centroidal axis after deformation also. So you remove this shear strain. There is only one strain only will be there in, you know, in Euler-Bernoulli beam theory also. Okay, so now let us say shear strain is neglected, say, more or less it is like our Euler-Bernoulli, okay? So the epsilon is, you know, so du by ds, this is our axial strain. So V by rho. So now shear strain is neglected. So this is zero. So you know they become like this. So they all of them. So psi becomes you know minus U by rho minus dV by dS. And of course your psi, it is nothing but d psi by dS. So this becomes, you know, minus d by dS. So you have to substitute psi here. So U by rho minus d square V by ds square. Okay, so if you neglect shear in your calculations, you know, so these are the strain displacement relations. Now if you neglect both of them, say, so shear strain, okay, and even the axial strain also, both we are neglecting now. So what is the meaning of this? Now if you neglect both of them, so now what happens? What is the physical meaning of them? So axial strain also we are neglecting, okay. Now, what does it mean? See, in our Euler-Bernoulli beam theory, where axial strain will be zero? No.
Neutral axis.
Neutral axis. So now here also, when I am talking about rods, say, okay, so you are having a rod like this, okay? It is like a curved beam kind of a thing, okay? So now this is our neutral axis. So generally in Euler-Bernoulli beam theory, what to do, you know, right? You draw a, you know, the strain like this. So at this place, you know, it is zero. So what does it mean if strain is zero at the neutral axis? Now, what type of, what is that meaning of that one? So when strain is zero, say, what do you call this one? Axial strain is zero. See, in Euler-Bernoulli, neutral axis, what happens? It becomes...
So no displacement there.
No, no, that is inextensible actually, you remember. See, at the neutral axis, you followed it, it is inextensible kind of a thing we say. So this is same as Euler-Bernoulli beam theory. So if neglect epsilon also, then shear strain also at our for our rod. So now, you know, you will get some more simplifications, okay? So rho into dou u by dou s. Then psi, this becomes minus u by rho minus d by ds. So rho into du by ds. So then we have this psi, this warping. Of course, this also you can neglect. Okay. So d psi by ds. So this becomes minus d by ds. So u by rho minus d square by ds square. So rho du by ds. Okay, so these are our expressions. Okay, and now if you take a straight rod, say, okay, so if the rod is straight, it there is no, you know, curvature here. So if it is a straight rod, you know, so which means, you know, your rho becomes infinity, the radius of curvature here. So now you followed, right? So now you can use your Euler-Bernoulli, you see that itself actually. Okay, and your s becomes you know, x itself, and your shear strain, say, okay. So if you remember, you know, this this warping coefficient, if you take this as m by ei, and your shear strain, say, so this comes from our strength of materials, okay, ga. So then you know, we can write our equation also. So psi is equal to m by ei, okay. So d psi by, you know, the dx. So you can write this, you know, so d by dx. Okay, so gamma minus dv by dx. So you will get these terms, and finally, so you can simplify and you can write our the equation using like this. So d square v by, you know, dx square is equal to minus m by ei. Okay, which is same as what you have studied in our strength of materials. Okay, plus if you have the shear components, generally we neglect in our strength of materials. So this is our equation. Okay. So if you neglect shear also, say, you followed. So what is V? V, as already we told you, right? V is nothing but the radial displacement. U is your tangential displacement. So if you neglect shear also, say, so once again, you go back to our fundamental equation. M is equal to EI, you know, d square y by dx square. So this also you can derive, okay, variety cases. So this is an extra term which if you include shear also into our calculations, okay. So now let us see the last one, which is very important for us, for circular bar, circular rod, okay. So which means, you know, rho is equal to r, this is a constant, and you can write ds as, you know, r times, you know, d phi. Okay, so this is our expression. So now you can, for circular rod, you can write all those equations. So epsilon becomes, you know, 1 by r. So du by, you know, so d phi minus v. Then shear strain, say, 1 by r. Okay, so u plus dv by d phi. Okay, plus you have this psi is here. Then your this warping constant. So 1 by r, so d psi by using d phi. Okay, so these are general equations. If you neglect, you know, shear as well as, you know, this epsilon, which means that it is same as the Euler-Bernoulli rod itself. Okay, so then V becomes, you know, so du by d phi. Okay, then psi becomes, you know, minus 1 by r. Okay. So u plus d square u by d phi square. So advantage is when you neglect shear and epsilon, say, so you don't have three displacements, three things. Everything can be expressed in terms of u itself. That is the main advantage which you have. Then your this also you can write as minus 1 by r square. So v plus d square v by, you know, d phi square. R, you can write everything in u itself. 1 by r square. Okay. So du by d phi plus d cube u by, you know, d phi cube. Okay, so these are our strain, you know, the displacement relations actually. So now you know what to do. You can do is you can, you write these are the strain displacement relations are there, you know, the, you know, the equilibrium equations here. So now you can combine actually, okay, everything, you know, for circular rods, say. So for circular rod, the strain displacement relations, and so if you combine the strain displacement and the equilibrium equations, okay, everything, if you combine all those things and do this one, so you can write one equation of equilibrium in terms of neglecting the shear. So neglecting epsilon and gamma, so you can write one by big equation you can derive, so which is our Lamb's equation you get. So d phi to the power of 6 plus 2, so d to the power of u by d phi 4 plus d square u by d phi square plus q r q. So only radial load is considered. So d to the power of 4 u by d phi to the power of 4 plus d square u by d phi square is equal to 0. So this is a famous the Lamb's equation. So neglecting epsilon and this one, and only radial load. Okay. So this is a famous what we can say is the Lamb's equation. Okay, for a circular arch, you follow. So nicely, and u is as already I told you. So u is in tangential displacement. Okay. So you can find out radial displacement also. So radial displacement will be simply derivative of this term itself. So you can write in terms of radial displacement, or you can write in terms of this tangential displacement itself. So this is how the Lamb's equation looks like. Now what is order of this equation?
Sixth order.
No, it is a sixth order, but of course it is a ODE because we have assumed that Euler, Bernoulli, all those things. So it is basically sixth order ODE. And now you can see, you followed, right? How complex these equations are. You followed. Generally for arches, it is very, very complex. And here, what we have done is, we have not even incorporated, you followed, right? Any non-linearity or, even the... In the strains, see, generally when you write expression for strains, okay, so you have higher order terms also will be there, like this, you followed in the continuum mechanics, you would have seen this one, higher order terms and all those things without incorporating everything, assuming this, so based on your Euler-Bernoulli, so plane sections remain plane, so here also assumption is plane sections are like rigid bodies only, but of course you can incorporate shear, or you can you follow it, delete shear itself. So if you incorporate shear, it becomes a Timoshenko beam kind of a thing. If you don't incorporate shear, say, so you go towards your Euler-Bernoulli beam theory itself. Okay, so it's a very, very complex equation if we have for rods. Now the boundary conditions, when the end is fixed end, say, okay, so fixed end means, as all of that the boundary conditions we write like this, the tangential and radial displacements. Okay, so we write like this, and the radial displacements and slope, okay, they are zero. So now how do we write this equation? So u is equal to zero, so u is your tangential displacement. What is radial displacement? See, radial displacement is v, so which means, what is v? So v anyway is related to du by d phi itself. Okay, so the radial displacement, which means so du by d phi itself. Okay, so this itself is zero. Then slope is also zero itself. So slope means so this is v, u is a tangential displacement, so dou u by dou phi has to be zero. So dou u by dou phi means you have to differentiate this two times. So dou square or dou phi square, say, of course d square, I'm sorry. So d square by d phi square, say, is equal to zero. So all the boundary conditions we are writing in terms of u itself. So so fixed end, say, so u, then u dash, then u double dash. Okay, so all of them are zero. So this is how we write the boundary conditions. Now if it is a hinged end, say, okay, so hinged end, we all know, right? Displacement is zero. Then bending moment is zero. Okay, so now for circular this rod, say, which means so u is zero, so that this other displacement, that is the tangential du by d phi, so this is also equal to zero, which is v, Okay, so this is also zero. Then we have, you know, the bending moment. See, generally here the bending moment is proportional to, you know, so if you see these expressions carefully, say, okay, so bending moment is proportional to, if you see here, so you can see like this expression, if you see, say, how bending moment is related to V, so it is related to your second derivative actually. And now what is the relationship between V and U? See, V and U, what's the relationship? So V and D, V, you know, once you have to differentiate U, then only you will get V. So now in the bending moment diagram, if you see here, M is equal to D square V. If you write in terms of U, say, okay, so it becomes, you see, a third derivative here. So generally, so the boundary conditions we write as, you know, so dou cube U by dou phi cube, say. So this is equal to, you know, the zero itself. Okay, suppose if there is any external moment is there, say, so something is there, so generally we write this as, you know, dou phi cube is, you know, r square by ei, okay, q, okay, into, you know, ms, okay. So this is how we write. So since the equation is written in terms of tangential displacement, so now so the boundary conditions also should be written in terms of, you see, the tangential displacements. Okay, so this is how we write. So third term, so now if you see fixed end and hinged end, say, you know, the first two are set, u and u dash is zero, but here u double dash is zero, but here u triple dash is zero because of, you know, this free, you know, free end, sorry, this hinged end, because the bending moment is zero. So this is how, you know, we can derive the equations, you know, for our, this problem. So now let us go back to our buckling, okay. So now already we have seen yesterday's class buckling from, you know, the Bosnick's equation. Now let us see from the Lamb's equation what happens. Okay, so now this is our Lamb's equation, as already I have written here. So this is our Lamb's equation. So now we want to find out, you see, the buckling. Now how to solve, okay. So buckling of a circular arch subjected to radial loads. Okay, so our equation is sixth order equation, okay. So now for our sixth order equation, say, now how do you find out? So how do you solve a sixth order ODE? So now what to do? So you have to write e to the power of, you see, you followed it, lambda phi or something. So you substitute, say, okay, in our Lamb's equation. So it is a sixth order ODE. So you will have a equation comes to find out the roots, lambda to the power of 6. 2 lambda to the power of 4 plus lambda square plus k lambda to the power of 4 plus lambda square is equal to 0, and k is, say, you know, q r cube, say, by e. So this is a sixth, so six roots will be there, okay. So first two roots are same, I think, is 0. Then the third root and fourth root, say, they are plus or minus imaginary number, and your 5 and 6, okay, so they are some plus or minus I times beta, where your beta e is, you know, root of 1 plus k. So six roots are there. So of course, two of them are identical. 5 and 6 are identical, 3 and 4 are identical, and 1 and 2 are 0 itself, okay. So now, and of course, so now the solution can be written as, you see, so u will be, so c1 plus c2 phi. So this turns out to be for the first one, okay. Then c3 is times sine phi. So this corresponds to plus or minus I. So c4 times cos phi, then the last one, so which corresponds to fifth root and sixth root, sine beta into phi plus c6 is cos beta into phi. So these are 5 and 6, these are 3 and 4, these are 1 and 2, okay. So now if you can write in terms of, this is for the tangential displacement. If you want to write for radial displacements, sometimes, you know, so which is anyway derivative, okay, so then this becomes c2 times c2 plus c3 cos phi minus c4 sine phi, okay, plus c5 beta cos of beta phi, okay, minus c6 beta sine beta into phi. Okay, so this is for the radial displacement, this is for the tangential displacement. Now, you know, we can choose based on the boundary conditions, and we can try to see this one. So now let's first see the our two hinged arch. So now let us see this one. So we are having an arch. Okay. So it is a hinged arch. So let us say, you know, so it's a central angle like whatever we did in the previous class. So, you know, so we can see the, I think the equation was like, I think the central angle is alpha. Yeah, so central angle is in alpha, which we did in the last class, okay, and it is subjected to radial load. Okay, so this is our sum Q or whatever here. Okay, so now last class I told you, see, like, you know, how this arch is going to buckle. No, what type of modes it will have. See, last class we told you, right? No,
asymmetric.
No, two asymmetric, anti-asymmetric, and other one is asymmetric mode shapes are there. Okay, so now so these are two hinged arcs. So already we solved using our Bosnick's equation. So now the boundary conditions here, what happens is you know, so at phi is equal to plus or minus alpha, that is at the supports. These are all simply supported. Okay, so which means you know, uv is zero, then u dash, that means your, this is also zero, then u triple dash, this is also zero. Okay, because you followed it, the bending moment is zero itself. So now you know, so now these are the, so how many conditions are there? 1, 2, 3, then 4, you followed it, we have. So now we have to get some other extra things also. Suppose if it is a symmetric form of buckling, say, symmetric form of buckling. So now suppose if it is a symmetric mode actually, now what happens, what is the boundary condition? See, last class you followed, right? I already told you. Okay, so if it is asymmetric, what we should use, and if it is symmetric, say, how you know, one should do this one. Now what's the boundary condition? See, last class we told you, right?
For symmetrics, a derivative of u will be zero.
Derivative, this will be zero. Or what you can say, you are, if you talk in terms of radial displacement, say, okay, so what should happen if it is a radial displacement? No, that is a fine, it is zero only for asymmetric, anti-symmetric case, radial displacement is zero. Okay, that is fine. But now if you see the form here, say, what type of form you are having here? See, this form is nothing but, you know, a symmetric form actually. So what does it mean? So if it is, if it has to be a symmetric form, say, the radial displacement, so your v, that is a radial displacement v, should be a even function actually. You followed. If it is anti-symmetric, say, it should be odd function. You followed. So now if it has to be an even function, say, so now which are the even functions here? So you can decide from our expression, say, for u or v or whatever. So if you decide this even function, so what are even functions here? If we are having sine and cos here, so what are the even functions here? No.
Cos is even.
So you followed, right? Cos and sine, you know, one is a even, other one is you know, the odd itself. Okay, so now so what we try to do is, so now you know, so we write u, so we take only the even functions here. So this is a tangential displacement, so c2 phi plus c3 sine phi plus c5 sine beta times phi. Why sine terms? The reason is you followed it. If you try to differentiate, so you will get cos term, and then, you know, it has to be even function. So these how we get. Okay, so now, so how many unknowns are there? There are only, you know, three cases only are there. So now you subject it to the boundary conditions. Okay, so our boundary conditions are, you know, c2 times alpha, c3 times sine alpha, plus c5 times sine beta times alpha is equal to 0, which means u is 0, then v is also 0, so c2 plus c3 cos alpha plus c5, okay, so c5 into beta cos of beta times alpha, this is also equal to 0, then the bending moment, so c3 times cos alpha minus c5 times beta cube cos beta times alpha, so this is also equal to 0. So if you write it in a matrix format, say, so you have alpha, sine alpha, sine beta times alpha, then 1 cos alpha, then beta into cos of beta times alpha, so 0, then minus cos alpha, so minus beta cube, say, cos of beta times alpha. Of course, c1, c2, c3, c5 will be 0, and for buckling, say, so determinant of this matrix has to go down actually. Okay, so now the equation will be alpha into beta minus beta cube plus beta cube you know, into tan alpha is equal to tan beta times alpha. So this is for symmetric mode shapes. So this is our characteristic equation, or you know, so solving this equation you will get your beta. So you have to solve for betas. We will see which one will be small, that will come later. So this is how, you know, we solve for beta. Now suppose if you take anti-symmetric, say. Okay. So anti-symmetric form if you take, so now your radial displacement, okay, so this should be, you know, odd function. You follow? So which means that the derivative, you know, that is u. You follow? So now you can write u as, you know, so you consider only these terms. So c1 plus c4 cos phi. Yes, one second. So c4, oh sorry. So c1 plus c4 times you know your cos phi plus c6 say cos of you know beta times phi. Okay. So now you use once again the boundary conditions here. So now the critical load equation say. So this turns out to be 1 cos alpha. Then we have a cos you know beta times alpha 0 minus sine times alpha. So minus beta. So sine times beta times alpha, then we have 0 sine alpha, then beta cube say sine you know, beta times alpha. Okay, so determinant of this matrix has to be 0. So now if you try to find out determinant, you know, it looks like this beta minus you know, beta cube. One second. Now minus cube sine alpha into sine beta alpha is equal to 0. So these are the equations. So these for anti-symmetric case and these for the symmetric case. So now we have to solve for you know the alpha itself. So we have to solve for this you know whatever this case, and you can get. So now if you see this, so these are our equations. So you have to solve for beta here. Now here the lowest root, if you see this term say, okay, so your sine alpha should be same as you know this has to be 0. This is one root comes like this, okay. So now this is something like you know a abnormal kind of a thing. So which means alpha is equal to you know n times phi. So if n is equal to 1, say, what does it tells you? What does it tells when n is equal to 1 and alpha is equal to pi? No. What type of arch it is? So what is alpha here?
Semicircular.
No, no. When alpha is equal to phi, what is alpha here? Be here. What is alpha?
Half of the angle.
Central angle. Okay. So now you know. So if alpha is pi, say, what will be the what type of arch it is? What type of shape you will get?
Full circle.
It is a full circle. Okay. So which is not no, but we are solving an arch problem. Okay. So this root has to be you know a deleted kind of a thing. Okay. So this anyway, you know, is ruled out. This root, okay. So the only way if you want to find out the buckling, this one says. So you have to do this becomes a closed ring. Which anyway, you know, our arch is not a closed ring kind of a thing. So which means what it is saying is your geometry itself is changing actually. You followed. So geometrically, you know, there's a changeable system. So which is not which is ruled out and you know, which is not acceptable because we are dealing with an arch, not a ring kind of a thing. Okay, so the only way is you know this equation. So sine beta alpha is equal to 0. So beta alpha is if followed right m times phi and beta square m square phi square by alpha square. So now here you can try. So this is for anti-symmetric case, you know, we have got this one. And k is you see beta square minus 1 and finally your QCR set. So this becomes m square pi square by you know this alpha square minus 1 multiplied by you know EI by R cube. Okay. So this is a critical buckling load. Now you can similarly you can solve for a symmetric form also. That is you know you solve this equation and then you find out you know the QCR set. Okay, so this is a transcendental equation here. So now you find out QCR for anti-symmetric and symmetric case. You will find out that you know the anti-symmetric case only will be the lowest actually. Okay, so this itself will be the lowest load. So generally in arches, you know, the anti-symmetric only will be the lowest kind of a thing, the buckling mode shape. Okay. So now if it is a semicircular arch, say. So which means you followed it, alpha is equal to, you know, pi by 2. What is the number you get here? So if you substitute alpha is equal to pi by 2 and m is equal to 1, say. So your QCR will be, no. So you substitute here alpha is equal to pi by 2. So pi square 3 pi square, 3 ei by alpha. What is this relation? Yesterday's class also we derived, no? What was the expression for this arch? Two hinged, hinged arch. Semicircular arch, you remember, from the Bosnick's equation. So Bosnick's equation also we got, you see, same 3 ei by, you know, this r cube itself. Okay. So this is how, you know, from both the sides, you can get the same answer itself. Okay. And then for hingeless arch, it is a fixed. So when the arch is fixed, same. So only thing is, you know, the boundary conditions are going to change, and you know, you can once again, you followed, right? You can try. Okay. So QCR, and if it is a semicircular arch, say. So your critical load for this case will be like this. So beta square, so you can derive minus 1, so EI is by R cube you will get, and if it is alpha is equal to, you know, pi by 2. Okay, so then automatically your QCR for semicircular arch, so this fit automatically turns to be 8 EI by R cube itself. And what was the fixed arch like last class we have got, you remember? See, for the fixed, you know, the arch, you know, what type of solution we got here in the last class? See, last class, what was the result we got? First, fixed and if it is semicircular arch, say, exactly, you know, the same itself.
Same.
So, which comes as a Bosnick's. Why we are getting same answer? What is the reason? No. See, now the Bosnick's equation is also based on what? See, Euler-Bernoulli beam theory. Now, Lamb's equation is something much more general, but here in deriving the Lamb's equations, what is that we have assumed? See, to derive that sixth order ODE, whatever we have done, we have made some assumptions. Now, what are the assumptions? What assumption we made? We are neglecting shear, we have neglected axial also. So when you neglect shear and axial, say, so both of them should be same itself, actually same as Euler-Bernoulli beam theory. That means, you know, plane sections remain plane, they are rigid. Okay, then plane sections remain perpendicular also to your deformation. So that means, you know, shear is also thrown out, actually. That's why, you know, you will get, you know, same, you know, same answers in the both the cases itself. Okay, but Lamb's equation is something much more general. You can derive for, you know, variety of cases, like it may not be a circular, it may be something else. Then you can try to solve the solution, actually. Okay. So I will stop here. So next class, you know, we will continue. So if you have anything to ask, you can ask me. So you people have got the book, right?